Hello and welcome to MediTalk. In this new episode of MediTalk, we are going to discuss an entirely different topic, depression as an illness. So joining us today is Dr. Anoop Ravindran, the Director of Mental Health Service in Ballarat. And so he's leading the mental health service in a large regional area in Victoria. Dr. Ravindran completed his medical degree of MBBS at Academy of Medical Sciences in Kannur, Kerala. Then he moved to the prestigious Christian Medical College in Vellore. You know, that is a center of academic excellence and is has got a world reputation. Then he came to Australia and worked at Origin Youth Mental Health Service, and he worked with some of the stalwarts in youth mental health. Then he took the leadership of Ballarat Mental Health Service. Welcome, Dr. Ravindran, and thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks, Albi.
So today we are going to discuss about depression. There are lots of talks about depression in the community, but sadness, I mean, all of us experience sadness. So it is a universal human experience. But why do you call it as depression? Or in other words, when does sadness become depression?
For me, when somebody talks about depression, or when someone asks me questions about depression, it's a very interesting question for me, because the word depression itself is a heterogeneous word. It doesn't have one meaning, but it has got lots of different meanings.
Right.
So the common person has got a meaning, and the general population has got a meaning, and medical professionals has got a different meaning. The depression, the medical professional or people like us in the medical profession talks about, is not the depression we come across in the everyday life by a common man. We are not talking about the sadness of everyday life, which comes and goes with everyone's life situations. We talk about a medical condition where the sadness is the prominent feature of that medical mental health status, where sadness is the prominent predominant mood of that person, where sadness is the persistent mood of that person.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So it should be there for a longer period than your everyday mood fluctuations. So for us, depression is not just a symptom, it's a syndrome. That means a constellation of symptoms, which includes a prominent, pervasive low mood and sadness, which persists almost on a prominent, pervasive way for majority of the day. If you look at the diagnostic criteria says that it should be there at least for a minimum of 2 weeks period.
So the time factor is very important.
Time factor is very important. And it is associated with a lot of other symptoms as well. The low mood is usually associated with a pervasive sense of tiredness. They're not able to do their routine daily activities to the extent that sometimes people with severe depression, they even find it really hard to brush their teeth, get out of the bed.
So it impacts some.
It impacts
very deeply. Yeah.
It definitely impacts significantly. The other features we come across during a depressed state is a lack of sleep. People find it hard to fall asleep, or they wake up from their sleep earlier than their usual time. They lose their appetite, their eating habits changes. They find it really hard to concentrate on the things they do. They find it hard to memorize things. People tend to be more forgetful during those periods. For example, if I talk about a everyday bank accountant's life, he keeps forgetting his calculations. He makes mistakes in his calculations, so it affects his occupational functioning as his work life as well. And if I talk about a homemaker may forget things inside the house. For example, if a mom is taking care of the baby, she may forget feeding the baby.
Yeah, so in many ways, it's clear that it is much more than a normal sadness.
Yes, it's an elephant in the room, and we sometimes look at it or we fail to acknowledge its presence.
Yeah.
So we have to acknowledge it as a problem and have to address it at the earliest.
Yeah, very interesting. So how common is it in the community?
Like I mentioned, I call depression as the elephant in the room. It's everywhere. And if you are looking at the worldwide statistics, the WHO, World Health Organization, says that it's the most common mental health disorders across the community, across the world. And if you look at individual countries, the developing countries or the third world countries have got a higher prevalence or higher occurrence of the depression. On an average, if we look for numbers, you can say that 1 in 7 to 8% develops a depressive episode once in their lifetime, at least once in their lifetime.
So that's a sizable magnitude.
Exactly. And WHO in January 2020 published their article, says that at that particular point of time, 264 million people were affected with depression. And the depression was quite a common cause for loss of daily functioning and quality of life. And from the Australian perspective, it is not different. In Australia also, it's pretty common, and it's common across the community.
Yeah, is it different in, is there any gender difference in its occurrence?
Of course, the most common age group where we come across this depression is the middle-aged people. Among them, there is a higher prevalence, higher occurrence of depression in females. So females are more vulnerable to develop depressive disorders than men. Doesn't mean that men does not develop depression. They do develop depression, but you may come across more depressed females than men in your daily life.
Yeah, that leads to the next question. Mm-hmm. There are normal, or I wouldn't say normal, there are variations in mood. For example, if there is a death in the family, people may feel low, and during losses in life, like for example, job loss. And we also know that women sometimes experiences mood changes just before menstrual cycles. So what can you tell us about that?
Albie, I think you're talking about how to differentiate between a normal kind of depressive reaction to a situation and how we differentiate it from a mental health disorder. So for that, I think I should touch upon the different varieties of depression.
Mm-hmm. That'll be a good,
we come across in our daily practice. So we all have low moods and sadness as part of our mind. That's a normal emotion. So we cannot medicalize the normal distress of a person.
Exactly, yeah.
We cannot label the normal sadness or the low mood of a person with a mental health diagnosis. So that is unfair on the person. That's against the medical ethics and the principles. So the loss of a loved one in your life is the most distressing event in your life.
Absolutely, and yeah.
Feeling sad, feeling that loss, and grieving is normal process. We all go through that grieving process. We all grieve the loss, but doesn't mean that that grieving process is equivalent to a depression or is could be called as a depression and needs treatment. Mm-hmm. A person who is grieving the loss or feeling sad, they will also have difficulties in sleeping. They will have struggles with their appetite. They won't feel like eating. They will be lacking interest in enjoyable, pleasurable activities. So it's that state mimics a major depressive disorder. But the interesting thing is the whole context is in and around the loss of that person. And usually the majority of the people, they come out of this grief situation without much medical help.
So they recover.
They recover automatically because that's a normal process, and the mind itself recovers out of it. They don't need any anybody's help. They don't need any doctor's help. They don't need any medical help.
Right.
So that state is a transient state, and it's associated with the loss, and it's a normal reaction to that loss.
That's very important for our audience to know that there are normal reactions to adverse life situations.
Exactly.
Am I right?
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So, and the normal reactions to adverse life events is not a mental health disorder and doesn't need mental health treatment. And we should not be medicalizing the human distresses. So that should be my take on the grief and loss. The next one, the next question you asked was about the menstrual cycles and women experiencing depressive symptoms or depressive-like symptoms with the menstrual cycles.
Mm-hmm.
So again, like I mentioned, there are different types of depression. The depression as a reaction to a life situation, like grieving, or failure in your life, a relationship breakdown, or you have lost your job, there is a financial crisis, or let's take COVID.
Very, very relevant. Yeah.
COVID is a very difficult life situation. You have lost your social connections. You have lost your job, employment, and you're struggling to adjust with it. There is every possibility that you may feel depressed and anxious, but doesn't mean that you are having a major depressive disorder. So we tend to call these as adjustment disorders.
The reactions to different life situations.
Yes.
Yeah.
Adjustment disorder, difficulty in adjusting to the difficult life circumstances. That's one kind of depression.
Right.
Then the major depressive disorders. Major depressive disorders are the one which needs mental health treatment, mental health professionals' input. They are pervasive, persistent low mood,
yep.
Lack of energy, motivation to do things, loss of pleasure in previously enjoyable activities. You're not able to enjoy the movies you used to watch in the past.
It's altogether. It's a different animal.
It's a totally different entity. It's a totally different entity.
Right. It's clear. Yeah.
And that's the depression we need to treat aggressively and assertively with the mental health professional. And the other one is a persistent depressive disorder. That means that the person is experiencing the depressive mood, low mood, for quite a long time. And it has been persisting for years.
Right, okay.
This type of persistent depression is usually related to chronic life difficulties. For example, if a person is having a difficult marriage relationship and there is constant fight inside the house, or somebody's beloved is having a chronic medical condition and suffering. So it is bound. It's the for that particular person who is the carer or who is part of that dynamics is bound to happen a long-term depressive symptom.
Yeah, thank you very much. You beautifully explained the subtleties of these syndromes, and as you mentioned, the marriage difficulties is very interesting, worth a topic to explore. We will definitely cover that topic sooner than later, but you mentioned the loss of sleep and some of the associated symptoms of depression.
Mm-hmm.
Naturally, people might wonder why it is happening. What is causing depression?
Oh, that's a very good question, Albi. We spoke about the life circumstances which causes the depression, but that's not the only reason for causing depression. There are a multitude of reasons for, or we call it as etiologies, or causative factors for depression. The most important one is the genetic vulnerability.
Oh, the genes.
The genes you have inherited. For example, depressions could run in families. It doesn't mean that everybody develops depression in the family, but people who have the genetic predisposition to develop depression are more vulnerable in difficult life circumstances. So we usually call it as a nature plus nurture combination.
That's a very nice way of putting it together.
Yeah, so yeah. A person with a genetic predisposition to develop a depression going through a difficult life circumstance or stressful life event is more vulnerable to develop major depressive disorders. We should not forget the depression which occurs because of medical problems.
Okay, yep.
For example, people experience having thyroid-related difficulties, hypothyroidism. Mm. Let's talk about hypothyroidism. The thyroid functions are low. So the thyroid is a very important organ which provides the hormone for the daily activities of your body, the metabolic activities of your body. When your thyroid is not working well, it affects the whole body's functioning and it affects your brain's function as well. If your brain is not working properly, you may feel sad. You may feel depressed, you may feel tired, you may feel loss of interest in doing things, you may feel loss of energy. So that mimics a depressive episode.
Very important to know, because that means depression need not be a character weakness all the time.
Yeah. people keep talking about strong people not developing depressions. Depression happens only to the weak people. That's a myth. That's a big time myth. Strength of your character, strength of your mind is not at all scientifically associated with occurrence of depression. There is no relationship to that. One thing we need to understand is your mind and body are one single unit. They both work hand in hand. So if your brain is not working well, you can have depressive episodes.
Mm.
If your body is not working well, you can have depressive episodes. Even the strongest person or the strongest character could develop depression. You must have heard a lot of popular people, successful men and women developing depression and providing testimonies about their experience of with depression. So that's one myth we need to bust a big time.
Any other myths about depression? I know there are a lot of scientific aspects into this topic. For example, you know, depression is always, I mean, you mentioned about it runs in the family and the genetic predisposition. Can it be related to drugs or something like that? Or
So, like I mentioned, for a mental health professional, depression is a very heterogeneous word. It doesn't specify a particular illness, but it specifies a particular state of mind. And that state of mind could be because of various reasons. Maybe I should use the analogy of a fever situation, a person developing fever. Fever is just a symptom, and that fever could be because of various other reasons. It could be because of tuberculosis, or it could be because of COVID. It could be because of malaria. It could be because of an infected wound in your hand. So like fever, depression is a state of your mental health. We need to look into the reasons or the causes for those depression. Like hypothyroidism, like life stressors, drug and alcohol plays an important role in causing depression. Example, the most common kind of depressions we come across because of the drug use are the alcohol dependence syndrome. People having alcoholism and then developing depressive disorders. People addicted to amphetamines and then developing depressive disorders.
Mm-hmm.
People addicted to other stimulant drugs and developing depressive disorders. So,
very important to know.
It is very important to see what the context of that depressed state is like and why we should treat the depression and where should be focusing on the treatment part.
This reminds me of the stigma, not just to depression, it is associated with mental illnesses in general. So if someone has symptoms of depression, that person may not share these symptoms with others.
Mm-hmm.
For a few possible reasons. One is stigma. I know we try to reduce stigma, but it is still there. The other reason could be lack of awareness.
Mm-hmm.
So what are the symptoms for the public to know so that a close person like a relative or a friend can pick up these symptoms of depression so that the person affected can get early treatment?
Mm-hmm.
So what can we tell the community about the symptoms that a close person can pick up?
Exactly. So not only because of the stigma with mental health conditions, it's also, like you mentioned, lack of awareness.
Right, yeah.
People are not aware of mental health disorders and they don't usually pick up these early warning signs or early signs of depression. And it'll be too late by the time they identify the changes in their partner or their family member or in their friend. People tend to withdraw from the society, the relationships, when they are depressed and worried.
Yeah, so that one of the early
warning signs could be a social withdrawal and a person becoming quiet in the relationship and not being seen and available in the relationship space. Lack of sleep, or people struggling to fall asleep or not sleeping enough is another early warning sign. People talking about hopelessness, no future, lack of interest in doing things moving towards future. That's another warning sign. They become extremely pessimistic. They don't see any point in doing things for their future. The other thing is people then start talking about death. May not be suicide, but death. That's another early warning sign. people losing interest in pleasurable activities. For example, if I am a person who enjoys the cricket, I will be definitely watching the TV, and definitely Australia-India series is going on and I will be glued into the TV. If I am depressed, I may not find that enjoyment in watching the telly. I may be sitting inside my room or I will be lying in my bed. Lack of energy. People finding it hard to do their day-to-day activities. That's another early warning sign. So these are the things you could keep an eye on, and these are the things you could easily pick on the people or identify in people who are showing some changes in their presentations.
So there could be a definite departure from that person's routine or usual habit and habitual pattern.
Exactly.
And there could be loss of sleep,
yep.
Appetite.
Yep.
A loss of weight, and so sometimes they may be indicating an underlying depression.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Now, what are the consequences of an untreated depressive episode?
When people think about depression, they always look at it from a very negative, pessimistic point of view, and believes that once somebody is depressed, that's the end of the world. In fact, it's not true. Depression affects people in different ways. And in the modern world and across the world, depression is one of the most common reasons for non-fatal losses of daily activity. So you lose your productivity. You fail to be productive in your life. Not only within your office space, within your family space. So that's the most important after effect or bad effect of a depression. Then there will be direct and indirect effects of somebody's depression on their family, their friends, their office spaces. The third and the most fatal, I won't say it's the least one, but it's the fatal one, it's the suicide risk. Around 80 to 90% of people who have committed suicide were depressed.
Oh, that's a huge impact.
Yeah. But doesn't mean that everybody with depression commits suicide. Yep. So that's the other way around. And as the severity of the depression increases, that's when the risk of suicide increases. If you are identifying and if you are treating depression earlier, just like any other illness, the outcomes are really good.
Yeah. When you talk about suicide, we know that we cannot prevent suicide on an absolute scale, or we cannot predict a suicide, but we may be able to reduce the risk of suicide. Mm-hmm. So from that angle, what are the warning signs of heightened suicidal risk? I mean, what can we do if someone is showing those sort of, especially the signs of depression and some gestures indicative of risk of suicide?
Yeah, that's a very important question. How do you predict suicide? I don't think we can absolutely predict suicide, like you mentioned.
Yeah.
But we could identify the vulnerable people, mm-hmm. or those who are at risk. Though women develop depressions more than men, men are at a higher risk of developing suicidal tendencies.
Right.
And completing suicides. So they seldom talk about the suicide and death, but they attempt in a lethal way. And men are more at risk of completed suicide than women. If somebody is talking about death and suicide, definitely you need to be very careful and sensitive towards that. If somebody is talking about being a worthless person or not having hope about his future, he is coming across as hopelessness. That's another warning sign. Mm. A person who had attempted self-harm or suicide in the past is at a higher risk of attempting suicide again.
Yeah, sometimes I heard from people in the community, that's a notion that if someone attempted to take his or her own life in the past, the notion is that that person will not attempt again. So that is not true.
So if you look at the literature says that 30% of the people who have attempted suicide in the past will definitely attempt suicide again, And during their second attempts, the risk of ending their life is higher than their first attempt. So that's another myth in the community, that once attempted may not or need not attempt suicide again. So there is a risk of multiple attempts when somebody is depressed. If a person is making some preparatory gestures, for example, talking about will, disclosing their bank details and providing all the information about their will to their beloved ones, that's another warning sign.
Yeah.
We mental health professionals consider that as a preparatory actor. So we should be extremely careful with those people.
It's very important to know.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you, Dr. Ravindran, again. Now, I mean, for our audience watching this sort of discussions, obviously it's not a pleasant topic by any means, but it's good to hear that it is not always pessimistic.
Mm-hmm.
So can I ask, it's a treatable disorder? If yes, what are the treatments available for depression?
I should admit the fact that when I started my psychiatry training, I also was holding to a lot of myths. One of the myths was once depressed, always depressed, and there is no treatment and cure for depression. My psychiatry training and my learning experiences with my clients have changed my whole perspective. Depression is just like any other medical or mental health problem where you can treat the person. There are evidence-based scientific treatments available, and the treatment outcome is really good like any other mental health disorder or medical problems. So a person who is identified as depressed, who's taken to the professionals for treatment, are definitely going to get scientific literature based evidence based medication and psychological therapies, which is going to be curative in its natural course.
So you're talking about the treatment for depression. It's very reassuring, Dr. Ravindran. So I don't think that we can stop here. We should come back to catch up again to discuss more about the treatment of depression and other psychiatric syndromes, for example, bipolar disorder, in the next episode of MediTalk. So stay tuned.